Our opening hymn is number 174. Number 174.
Service continues on page 80 in the Book of Common Prayer, page 80 in the Book of Common Prayer. Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever will be forever. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia, the Lord is risen. Come, let us adore him. Alleluia. Together we'll pray Christ our Passover, found on page 83. Christ our Passover. Alleluia. Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Alleluia. Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Alleluia. Come, let us adore him. Alleluia. Our psalm appointed for today is Psalm 31, found on page 622, page 622 in the Book of Common Prayer, Psalm 31. We'll pray the psalm together. Psalm 31 on page 622, page 622 in the Book of Common Prayer. Together we pray. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Incline your ear to me. Make haste to deliver me. Be my rock, a castle to keep me safe. For you are my crag and my stronghold. For the sake of your name, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net they have secretly set for me. For you are my tower of strength. Into your hands I commend my spirit. For you have redeemed me, O Lord, O God of truth. I hate those who cling to worthless idols, and I put my trust in the Lord. I will rejoice and be glad because of your mercy. For you have seen my affliction. You know my distress. You have not shut me up in the power of the enemy. You have set my feet in an open place. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, and also my throat and my belly. For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbors, a dismay to those of my acquaintance. When they see me in the secret, they avoid me. I am forgotten like a dead man out of mind. I am as useless as a broken pot, for I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is all around. They put their heads together against me. They plot to take my life. But as for me, I have trusted in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness save me. Lord, let me not be ashamed for having called upon you. Rather, let the wicked be put to shame. Let them be silent in the grave. Let the lying lips be silenced which speak against the righteous, haughtily, disdainfully, and with contempt. How great is your goodness, O Lord, which you have laid up for those who fear you, which you have done in the sight of all, for those who put their trust in you. You hide them in the covert of your presence from those who slander them. You keep them in your shelter from the strife of tongues. Blessed be the Lord, for he has shown me the wonders of his love in a besieged city. Yet I said in my alarm, I have been cut off from the sight of your eyes. Nevertheless, you heard the sound of my entreaty when I cried out to you. Love the Lord, all you who worship him. The Lord protects the faithful, but repays to the full those who act haughtily. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We're not already seated. Please be seated. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their cloaks at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord. Thanks
be to God.
Let us pray together. Canticle 8, found on page 85. Page 85 in the Book of Common Prayer. Canticle 8. And we will pray the canticle together. Canticle 8 on page 85. I will sing to the Lord, for he is lofty and uplifted, the horse and its rider as he hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my refuge. The Lord has become my Savior. This is my God, and I will praise him, the God of my people, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a mighty warrior. Yahweh is his name. The chariots of Pharaoh and his army has he hurled into the sea. The finest of those who bear armor have been drowned in the Red Sea. The fathomless deep has overwhelmed them. They sank into the depths like a stone. Your right hand, O Lord, is glorious in might. Your right hand, O Lord, has overthrown the enemy. Who can be compared with you, O Lord, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, awesome in renown, and worker of wonders? You stretch forth your right hand. The earth swallowed them up. With your constant love, you led the people you redeemed. With your might, you brought them in safety to your holy dwelling. You will bring them in and plant them on the mount of your possession, the resting place you have made for yourself, O Lord, the sanctuary, O Lord, that your hand has established. The Lord shall reign forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourself be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, then, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him, who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Our gradual hymn is number 366, number 366. We will sing verses 1 through 4.
Said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and still you do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The grace and peace of God our Father, the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. As we have been sheltering in place, I've been thinking a lot about our places. Our family moved into a new home, the first home we've ever owned, in October. Good thing we did. We didn't know all that would happen. And to be honest, in most of my life, I never really considered or thought much about owning a home. I grew up in a small town, but I lived in a couple different houses, so I wasn't necessarily terribly attached to where I lived. And then I was in religious life in college and moving around a lot, and usually lived in rectories, so the idea of owning my own home never really stuck in my mind as all that important. And yet I have to say that having a place where I know I'm going to be a while, and where I have to fix things, and where you settle roots, it makes a difference. And I think that idea of place is very important for each of us. Whether it be a family home, or whether it be a hometown, or whether it be certain places that have become important to us. School, a place where we got engaged or married or what have you, places matter. And I've been struck by a number of people who've reached out over these past months when we have been unable to gather, and how many people have said that it means a lot that we do our Sunday services in this place, in St. John's Church, because for people who are connected here, they miss being here, so at least they can see week in and week out this place, which is so important to many of our faith. And I get that. I think I would be missing something if I couldn't at least celebrate prayer with you in this place virtually. So place is really important. It sinks deep into our hearts, even though we might not always know it. And so, in the gospel reading today, when Jesus uses the image of place and actually goes a bit further and uses the image of the Father's house, I think he's saying something very important. Notice he says, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places, and I will go and prepare a place for you, so that where I am, you also may be." I use this reading often for funerals because I think it's comforting to remember that Jesus prepares a place for us. And when someone dies, when we gather to remember them and to pray for them and celebrate their life, I think an excellent image all often is that idea of family home and place, where there are many dwelling places in the household of God, and we hope and pray that we have a place as well. I think that is so true, and it goes deeper. Christians have been accused of being too focused on the next life, and arguably, we sometimes have been. We look at our faith as mainly a way to get to heaven or to the afterlife and save our souls. And we look at our outreach to others as trying to save their souls so they can get into heaven too. Now, I certainly believe in an afterlife, and I believe in heaven as we understand that now. And I do believe that God longs for us to be in communion. And when we die, life is changed, not ended. And I think, too, when Jesus says, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places, and I prepare a place for you," I think we can look at that not just from the vantage point of eternal life with God, but also what our life here on earth is supposed to look like. St. Teresa of Avila, the 16th century mystic, used the idea of dwelling places to talk about the soul's journey towards God. She uses the idea of the interior castle, and basically in our journey towards union with God, we enter many dwelling places, seeking union with the Lord, seeking union with the king of the castle who's at the center. And she talks expertly about the different rooms that we have to go through, the ways in which we have to give up our pride and ego, the ways in which we have to come face to face with our sinfulness in the outer dwelling places. And as we get closer to God, the ways in which we need to surrender not our sinfulness anymore, but our images of God, the ways in which we make God too small, and the ways in which we get in the way of God's action in our life, not letting God be God, who is pure love and pure reality. And union with God goes so much deeper than we can ever comprehend. That certainly is an image of dwelling place that I think is very helpful. There's another, though, that comes from the African-American spiritual where they talk about plenty good room. We sometimes forget in our world where we classify and where we look at one another as other, that in God's house there are many dwelling places. And certainly, God's household is big enough to include many different kinds of Christians and many people of goodwill. And how we sometimes do violence to one another by excluding and pushing out and making judgments where we are not qualified to do so. I'm always surprised at Christians who know the scriptures so well and know different parts of the scriptures so well, yet ignore those parts of scriptures that say things like, "Judge not lest ye be judged," or Matthew 25 that reminds us that coming to know God, recognizing who is on the sheep and the goats, actually comes from doing the works of God, not so much in what church we belong to or what camp we profess allegiance to. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. The other thing that's really important in this passage are the two apostles who kind of get it wrong. Thomas, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus corrects him and says, of course you know the way. And then Philip, who also questions Jesus, just show us the Father and we'll believe. And Jesus has to say to Philip, I've been with you all this time and still you don't know me. Abraham Joshua Heschel, the Jewish theologian and philosopher and scripture scholar and mystic, points out that his experience of reading scripture suggests that those who don't believe in God, those who push the image of God away, are referred to as fools in scripture. And indeed, you can read in the Psalms, the fool says in their heart, there is no God. He's not doing that to put people down who authentically doubt or who struggle. But he does point out that it's foolish to think that this world is only what you can see and test. And for those who rely only on what they know through their senses, meaning those things they can touch are the only things they'll believe in, are foolish. Because the world is full of so much more. And actually, we know so much more than just those things that we can see and touch. I often argue to people that if you know what it's like to be loved, then you know God. If you know what it's like to see goodness in action, then you know God. If you know what it's like to feel wonder and awe, even if it's by something that you can explain, like the laugh of a child or a sunset that surprises you, then you know God. There are so many ways in which we experience the Father, in which we have come to experience God in our lives, and yet we easily dismiss them because They're not exceptional in our mind. And yet that is how God most clearly comes to us and shows God's face to us each and every day, and sometimes multiple times throughout the day. Yes, this idea of place and dwelling place is so important, especially for us who may be encountering struggles as we shelter in place. Those of us who have to be separated from family and friends and have been for an extended period of time. For those of us for whom this Mother's Day will be painful, maybe because our mothers are no longer with us, maybe because our mothers are somewhere else and we cannot be together, maybe because we're fearing for their safety or ours. And yet, in these most uncertain times, we can go back to that place, those places in our world, but more especially those places and with us, in which we can regularly and do regularly touch the divine. The other day was the feast day of St. Julian of Norwich. St. Julian of Norwich lived in the 1300s, and she lived through the Black Plague, the time when Europe was decimated and two-thirds of the population died. Julian herself was an anchoress who lived next to her parish church. And she herself almost died, probably of the plague, but she recovered. And in her recovering, she had a vision of God, a vision of Jesus who was holding the world in the palm of his hand like a hazelnut. And she knew, and the famous lines are, that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. It's a reminder to us that she living in her day and us living in our day have to remember that we hold two things in tension. We hold in tension and we live in this world where there is pain and suffering and death and fear and all those things that we struggle with. And at the same time, we believe in this God who has come to us and who holds us and who prepares a place for us and who takes care of us. And so while we may be discouraged, we never lose hope. While we may doubt, we never despair. While it may look dark, we always, always, always look for the light. God prepares a place for us, has a place for us. We have a home. I think we always need to remember. Our service continues on page 96 in the Book of Common Prayer with the Apostles' Creed, found on page 96. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Suffrages A. Show us your mercy, O Lord,
and grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God,
and sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing for our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretch out your arms of love on the hardwood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you for the honor of your name. Amen. So we have a few announcements, I guess, kind of the same. We have coffee hour today on Zoom at 10:30. Hopefully you've gotten the link, or we'll get the link, depending on when you watch the service. We will be doing Compline. We're going to change it up a little bit, because Sunday night's a bit light, I think, because people have already seen the service. So we're going to do Compline from Monday to Thursday. So Monday night to Thursday night, 8 p.m. So we'll be on Zoom and Facebook Live, and we'll send you the link for that. Also, Father John has his Bible study on Tuesdays at noon, I believe. And something else coming up is the Red Cross will be doing a blood drive at St. John's on May 23rd, not March. We're in suspended animation. And we'll send out more information about the blood drive that's coming up. Blood banks are pretty low, so we are opening our doors, and they have assured us of social distancing and all the other precautions that need to be taken to be able to safely do that. So we'll be letting you know about that. Also, it is Mother's Day this weekend, so we'll offer a prayer for mothers. This prayer is for all mothers, those who are mothers by birth, birth, for grandmothers, for those who are godmothers, for those who have fostered children, for those who nurture and support in whatever way. So this is a prayer for mothers in any way on this Mother's Day weekend. Loving God, as a mother gives life and nourishment to her children, so watch over your church. Bless these mothers, that they may be strengthened as Christian mothers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their daughters and sons, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our service continues with the prayers of the people found on page 383, page 383 in the Book of Common Prayer. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For our bishop and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For this town of Marcellus, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widows and orphans, and for the sick and suffering, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For Christine, Jeffrey, Christy, Tiffany, Frank, Alexa, Carmen, Nancy, Heather, Chris, Maureen, Allison, Jimmy, Bill, Steve, Marie, Liz, Carrie, John, Margaret, Rob, Shoyley, Matthew, Bryn, Edward, Hale, Griffin, Jack, Mary Ellen, and are there others? Let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, for Stephen, for Edith, Ray, John, Matthew, are there others? And for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord,
have mercy.
In the communion of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. John, St. Julian of Norwich, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord, our God.
Our service will conclude with the prayer of St. Chrysostom, found on page 102, page 102 in the Book of Common Prayer. Together, Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Amen.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our closing hymn is Lead Me, Guide Me. It will be led by the Bartolotta family.
Take your